Good morning and welcome on this glorious morning as we worship together and celebrate the love God has for all of us. Each of you, whether you are worshiping with us here at the park in person or if you are with us online, welcome. We're glad you are with us and you make a difference in God's call and God's kingdom. Our pathway to make disciples for Jesus Christ, we do the following: living our faith, nurturing families, serving our communities. Today we are honoring our graduates, high school and advanced degrees. Nathan, Lisa, Josie, and Vicky have completed their degrees, but have only begun their new journeys. We'll give them an opportunity to share in the service and invite you to congratulate them and keep them in your prayers. King's Brass Concert is today at 6 p.m. in the sanctuary. We invite you to plan to attend and invite neighbors and friends to join you. Every Sunday, we offer a gift to our guests. If you are a guest with us, a first-time guest, welcome. We're glad you are here. And there is a gift for you at our welcome table in front of the lodge. You are welcome to come and take one of those gifts with you. If you have a guest with you or you see someone, feel free as a member of this congregation to hand those out. We're glad they are here. Today we will be celebrating Holy Communion, Christ's gift to us. And as we celebrate, there will be two different ways that we'll celebrate here in person. One of those is if you want to remain in your seats, there are the pre-packaged. Again, those are at the welcome table as you came in. You can receive those and just stay in your seats. If you wish to come forward, there will be three stations, one here, one on the corner of the sidewalk, and one down by the patio. So there will be three stations to come forward. As you come forward at a station, you'll receive a piece of bread. You'll dip your bread in the cup, and then you'll receive both the bread and the juice at the same time. So you're welcome to come forward, and everyone is welcome to receive Christ's gift. If you are worshiping with us at home, we invite you to have your own elements of bread and juice available, so that you can join us in Christ's gift. Let us now, as we are the children of God gathered to fellowship and welcome one another to worship, let us stand and greet one another in the spirit of the risen Christ. As you return to your seats, we will center our hearts for worship with the music from our jazz combo. Join me in standing for our call to worship and our hymn that follows. Open our ears. Open our eyes. Open our arms. Open our minds. Open our hearts to the joy of new life. Children, would you come on up, please? All right, I think if each of you get around on the side, you can see this a little bit better. I'm wondering if there is something about a God that's especially important to you. His love. So you think of God as love. Okay. Anyone else? Also love, okay? Anything? Well, you may have heard this story at one point or another. You can come a little closer if you want to be able to see. You've heard this story probably once or so with me a few years ago or some time ago, but it's always worth hearing again, yeah? It's a story called In God's Name, and it's by Sandy Sasso. And I thought we'd read this today. After God created the world, all living things on earth were given a name. The plants and the trees and the animals and the fish. And each person, young and old, had a special name. But no one knew the name for God. So each person searched for God's name. The farmer, whose skin was dark like the rich brown earth from which all things grew, called God Source of Life. The girl whose skin was golden as the sun that turned night into day called God Creator of Light. The man who tended sheep in the valley called God Shepherd. And the tired soldier who fought too many wars called God Maker of Peace. The artist who carved figures from the earth's hard stone called God My Rock. And sometimes the people who call God by different names were puzzled. They said every living thing has a single name, the marigold, the pansy, the lily, the oak tree, the sequoia, and the pine. God must have a single name that is greater and more wonderful than all other names. And each person thought his name for God was the greatest. Each person thought her name for God was the very best. The farmer who called God Source of Life said, "This is the true name for God." And the girl who called God Creator of Light insisted, "This is the most splendid name for God." And the shepherd and soldier and artist believed each had the perfect name for God. But no one listened, least of all God. And so each person kept searching for God's name. The woman who cared for the sick called God Healer. The slave who was freed from bondage called God Redeemer. And the grandfather whose hair was white with years called God Ancient One. And the grandmother who was bent with age and sorrow called God Comforter. And the young woman who nursed her newborn son called God Mother. And the young man who held the hand of his tiny baby daughter called God Father. And the child who was lonely called God Friend. All the people called God by different names, and they tried to tell one another that their name was the best, the only name for God, and that all other names were wrong. But no one listened, least of all God. And so each person kept searching for God's name. Then, one day, the person who called God Ancient One, and the one who called God Friend, and the one who called God Mother, and the one who called God Father, all the people who called God by a different name came together, and they knelt by a lake that was clear and quiet like a mirror, God's mirror. Then each person who had a name for God looked at the others who had a different name. They looked into God's mirror, and they saw their own faces and the faces of all the others, and they called out their names for God, Source of Life, Creator of Light, Shepherd, Maker of Peace, My Rock, Healer, Redeemer, Ancient One, Comforter, Mother, Father, Friend, all at the same time. And at that moment, the people knew that all the names for God were good, and no name was better than another. And then all at once, their voices came together, and they called God One. Everyone listened. Most of all, God. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for being with each one of us just as we need you to be. Amen. Okay, kids, I have for you a little bag. There's a bookmark inside that is a scratch-off. So I thought that maybe during the service today, you could make your own picture for God, on the scratch off and show it to me. I'd be interested to see what it looks like after the service. Would you do that? All right. There you go. It is our active love that reveals who we worship. As we give our financial gifts to God, let us also give our whole selves, giving our prayers, presents, and treasures to the church. We expect that God will use them to further God's dream for Anderson and the world. Let us give now to God. Thank you. Divine One, we promise to use these gifts for good. We promise to use these gifts to spread your kingdom on earth. We commit to using these gifts in love and mercy for others. Bless our efforts. Amen. It is a privilege this morning to invite our four graduates to come up and join me up here. I'm going to invite them to share a little bit about themselves, whatever they would like to share, but first by introducing themselves and then sharing. It's a joy to have a privilege to honor these four this morning. We'll start here with Nathan.
Hi, my name is Nathan Walker. I graduated from Alexandria Monroe High School as of 2 weeks ago, I think. And future plans and CNC work and whatnot, being a machinist. And what, musician, play guitar, bass, drums, I like that one. That's pretty much the gist. I'm glad to be here. Been here most of my life, but ready to move on in life.
Good morning. One small change. I'm privileged to be grouped in with Lisa Marie Presley, but my middle name is actually Ann, so it's Lisa Ann Jones. Been a member here since 1978. Got married here. Raised my kids here. I actually joined the church before I started college the first time, so I kind of closed a circle this week, finished a bucket list item, however you want to put it. I'm going to stick with doing what I'm doing, but I want to get back to food service and nutrition and move my life that way a little bit, I think. And thank you for all your support over the years.
I'm Josie Strock. I've been at this church all of my life. I was baptized and confirmed here. I just graduated with a bachelor's in chemistry from Purdue with a focus in pre-medical studies, and I'm working as an EMT for Lifeline in Indianapolis right now, and then hopefully I'll be starting med school sometime soon, so we'll see.
And I'm Vicki Strock, and I just completed a master's in jurisprudence from IU School of Law at McKinney and IUPUI, so I've been a member of this church since, I think it's in the bulletin, but I don't remember what year now. And both our kids were raised here. Both were baptized here and confirmed here. And we've had a long, good history with this church. So right now I plan to stay in my current position, but have been looking at risk management positions within our within my current place of employment. Thanks.
We have a blessing that we will offer for these folks. We offer that may God watch over you and protect you. You have begun a journey. At the end of one, you begin another. We ask that God walk with you, that God give you wisdom and guidance, that God give you joy in all that you do and pursue. May your soul always be fed at Christ's table. May your heart always be open in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And may your mind be transformed by the mighty presence of the great I Am. God is with you. God is with us. Go with God. Amen. We have a gift for you. They're receiving a gift certificate from Amazon, something that I think everybody can use. Wide variety of things. And again, let us praise God for these. Thank you. You may be seated. No, you don't.
Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we are gathered in this sacred space this morning because we want to worship you in the company of your people. We honor your name because you have been with us in awesome ways over this past week. We celebrate with these graduates. We celebrate the warmth of the season and the bright colors of flowers and the green of leaves on the trees. We cannot help but say thank you. As we have faced the various struggles of life, and as the people of our world struggle to find healthy ways to live with each other, you have been with us, protecting and guiding and strengthening us. You have brought us through another week, and we thank you. As we look ahead, facing uncertain times, we remember that you are the one we can trust with our very lives. You will show us the way, and you will walk the way with us. Thank you. We praise your glorious name. Because of Jesus, we know we can be right with you and right with others. Thank you for Jesus. And because of your Holy Spirit at work in us, we know that we have all the resources we need to do everything, absolutely everything that you call us to do for your glory and for the sake of all people whom you love. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. And when we fail to live according to your will and way for us, and when we fail to be the faithful disciple of Jesus you so desire of us, we thank you for not giving up on us. Thank you for throwing our failures into the deepest ocean and not counting them against us anymore. Thank you for the forgiveness you so freely give to any repentant heart. Thank you. And God, as you have forgiven us, help us likewise to forgive others. We cannot do this on our own. We need your own forgiveness to well up inside, to overflowing. We want to be like you. Help us, we pray. Because we know you care and because you work in our lives for good, we have confidence to tell you what we are concerned about and to ask that you make a difference for good in the lives of the people we love and situations that are beyond our ability to manage. We pray for peace and goodwill and hope in our world. We pray that truth and justice will prevail. We pray that those who have no home and no opportunity and no voice would not be overlooked and forgotten, that they are your beloved children too. We pray for those who are struggling with the awful effects of war and famine. We pray for the church and for our congregation. Help us to listen well to your voice and to respond with courage and obedience. For those among us who are ill, we pray that your healing presence be with them. And we pray all these things with joy in the reality of our eternal presence with you. Amen. Thank you.
please stand as you are able for the reading of the Gospel. The Gospel today is from John 17:1 and 13-23. Jesus said these things. Then, raising his eyes in prayer, he said, "Now I'm returning to you. I'm saying these things in the world's hearing so my people can experience my joy completed in them. I gave them your word. The godless world hated them because of it, because they didn't join the world's ways just as I didn't join the world's ways. I'm not asking that you take them out of the world, but that you guard them from the evil one. They are no more defined by the world than I am defined by the world. Make them holy, consecrated with the truth. Your word is consecrating truth. In the same way that you gave me a mission in the world, I give them a mission in the world. I'm consecrating myself for their sakes so that they'll be truth consecrated in their mission. I'm praying not only for them, but also for those who will believe in me because of them and their witness about me. The goal is for all of them to become one heart and mind, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, so they might be one heart and mind with us. Then the world might believe that you, in fact, sent me. The same glory you gave me, I gave them, so they'll be as unified and together as we are, I in them and you in me. Then they'll be mature in this oneness, and I give the godless world evidence that you've sent me and love them in the same way you loved me." This is God's word for God's people today.
Thanks be to God.
In Genesis 2:18, it says, "No person, no man," in the literal translation, "no person, it's not good for any person to be alone." And this has been researched extensively. Scientists have picked up on that from Genesis, and they have studied loneliness and being alone, and they've done this for generations. The most recent study they did with carpenter ants. And they removed a carpenter ant from the colony and they placed it by itself. They provided everything that it would have had with if it was in the colony, except it was alone. It began to deteriorate immediately. Its lifespan almost consistently across the board, as they did this with other experiments, other tests with carpenter ants, 1/10 the lifespan. So being separated, being alone, being out of place, survival's kind of iffy, right? That's what they've decided. That's what they're discovering about being alone. Then we have Jesus's words. "You are in this world, but you are not of this world." We're out of place as Christians, right? Well, let me explain a little bit. You see, what Jesus was saying is that as a Christian, it doesn't matter where we live. It doesn't matter our culture. It doesn't matter our language. It doesn't matter our dress. None of that matters. Wherever we are a stranger in the world. Because you see, when we accept Jesus Christ, we don't get a secret handshake. We don't get a passport. We get a green card. One way to describe a Christian in this world is we are a resident alien. So you see, we come to this world, and Jesus was trying to explain to his disciples, trying to explain to us what that means, what it means to be in the world, but not of the world. And so Jesus prayed in John 17, the entire chapter of this gospel, chapter 17 is Jesus's longest prayer. And it's a prayer just before his death. just before he was arrested, the night before all of that took place, he was praying this for his disciples. He was praying it so they could hear his prayer to God on their behalf, on our behalf. So Jesus was praying to God this prayer. And the Gospel of John, when we talk about the world, I'm thinking, how can we not be a part of this glorious world? I mean, look around. It is just filled with beauty. I personally want to be a part of that. That's not what John was talking about. When he used the word world here, he meant human rebellion that had filled the world. That's what he was referring to. So this human rebellion that was taking place in the world, it was the cultures, the customs, the traditions, the laws, all of those that opposed or were at odds with God. That's the world John's talking about. And so you see, we have this dichotomy. We have this tension for us. We're in a place, we're living and existing in a place. We are to enjoy what we have, yes, by all means, but we are not limited to here. So Jesus was, by all rights, praying for his disciples. Jesus was praying for several things for his disciples. Two of these I want to lift up today. First one is Jesus was praying for our protection, theirs and ours, and all those to come. Now, protection doesn't necessarily mean here that we won't experience hardship or pain or suffering. That's not what Jesus is talking about. I mean, for example, all of those disciples, those original ones who were hearing him, those original 12, if the historical counts are correct, they all died martyrs, terrible deaths. And then we have Peter, who was hung on a cross to die, and we have Judas, who hung himself from a tree. What difference is there? It doesn't seem that Jesus is protecting anybody. But protection looks different in God's economy. You see, he was protecting us so that we could be strong in the face of adversity. Read an article recently about cattle ranches in Wyoming. And the phenomenon that when there were terrible blizzards out there and snow blizzards, that there most of the cattle, many of the cattle, would turn their backs to the blizzard and begin to walk. The problem was, if they came to a fence, they just piled up and dozens would die as they tried to escape the storm. However, the person that was being interviewed about the cattle out in Wyoming said there is one breed that when there's a terrible blizzard happening, they turn and shoulder to shoulder, they face the storm with their heads down. They face it and they endure it. And almost 100% of those cattle survive those storms. That's what God's protection looks like. God gives us the strength to not give up, to not quit, to continue to move forward and continue to survive and thrive. That's what God's protection looks like. And then Jesus says he wants to give us joy. Excuse me. Wants to give us joy. And joy is something that, again, in God's economy, looks a little bit different. The world offers us entertainment. God's gift to us is joy. And so we are to accept God's joy, but it looks different than what we might think. Joy is when we can get over ourselves and stop being self-centered or selfish. When we can begin to think of others beyond ourselves and make them the first thoughts that come to mind, rather than the woe is me thoughts of life. God gives us a different picture of what joy looks like. There were a group of pastors that were talking about the best translations of the Bible, and one just stood very firmly and said, I believe that we need to all be reading the King James Version of the Bible. It's the first English version that came to us, and so it's the version that we need to use. And the next pastor said, well, I use the NRSV, the New Revised Standard Version, because it is very, it's very good translation, and it's used for in-depth study. And I just stand by that version. And the next one stood up and said, hey, the message is for me. It speaks in the language of the people today. It's easier to understand and hear what God has to say to me. And the fourth clergy stood up and said, I prefer my mother's translation of the Bible. Well, that got all their attention. They said, we're very impressed that your mother knows the Greek and the Hebrew and can translate the scriptures. And he said, oh, she doesn't. But through how she lives, I learned the gospel. And folks, that's where we find joy. When people can see the gospel in us, when others see gospel living through us, people who may never ever open up the Bible for themselves, but can know Jesus Christ by seeing how we live and what we say, how we respond, that's where we find the joy that Christ is talking about. That's not of this world. For me, it was hard to still understand. In this world, but not of it. Yes, we are called to be different. To find protection and joy differently than the world might perceive it. But there's another image from science that I just really treasure. And there happens to be a spider, of all critters, I know. But there happens to be a spider that makes its home underwater. The spider actually goes underwater and attaches a web to the rock on the bottom of the water, the body of water. And the web is in the form of a bubble. And then the spider goes back up to the surface of the water, and on the hairs of its legs, so it can carry a lot at one time. It has 8 legs, right? So on the hairs of its legs, it collects little bubbles of air, little air bubbles. And then it submerges itself, and it goes down and it releases those air bubbles off of its legs into its bubble, and it inflates it. And it does it over and over and over until there's a little orb, a little world of air pocketed down under the water, attached to the rock. And then the spider inserts itself. herself and lives there in its bubble. Folks, we are kind of like that. We are called to bring little bits of heaven into the world, to carry it with us so that all others in the world can see it in us. Where we are in this world, but we're not of the world. We're bringing a little bit of heaven to it. As we prepare our hearts and our minds to come forward to receive Holy Communion, let us think in terms of receiving a bit of heaven that we may take it with us into the world. As we prepare, let us sing together, Spirit of the Living God. Lift up your hearts and give thanks to God.
We join together to praise God.
Blessed are you, O God, who with your word and Holy Spirit created all things and called them good. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. Through Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead this same Jesus who now reigns with you in glory and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took the bread. He blessed it. He broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper was over, he took the cup, he blessed it, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this wine, we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at your table forever. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Let us now join together in praying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite those who will be assisting in communion to please come forward at this time. They will receive, and then they will be stationed out here. Again, we'll have a station near the patio, one at the corner of the sidewalk, and one right up here. Come, the Lord's table is ready. God of grace, you have restored us with minds to know you, hearts to love you, and voices to sing your praise. May we celebrate your glory and worship you in all that we are today and every day. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us stand and receive the benediction. Folks, you as Christians are residents of heaven. You are here as ambassadors of heaven, representing the God who loves you, who protects you, who brings you joy. Go now and take a piece of heaven with you. Amen.